Good morning and welcome to the first conference on state fragility organized by the G7 Plus and the Lisbon Club. Are we all aware that more than 1.5 million people live in conflict-affected countries? And that most of these countries are rich in valuable natural resources, which, if well managed, can drive economic growth and prosperity? In this context, there are complex challenges, difficulties, and also opportunities. Since we are in Lisbon, I will switch to Portuguese and kindly ask you to switch on your translation devices if needed. Esta conferência irá partilhar experiências e contribuir para novas perspectivas sobre a governação e gestão dos recursos naturais, com vista a reforçar a paz e promover a resiliência e o desenvolvimento. Esta é a primeira de uma série de conferências bienais organizadas pelo G7+ e o Clube de Lisboa, para dar a conhecer e debater os desafios enfrentados por países frágeis e afetados por conflitos. Contamos para isso com a inestimável colaboração dos nossos parceiros, o Camões, Instituto da Cooperação e da Língua, a OCDE, o Instituto Marquês de Vale Flor e a Câmara Municipal de Lisboa, a quem agradecemos, bem como à EDP, que tão simpaticamente nos acolhe. Temos connosco, para a sessão de abertura, Sua Excelência, o Ministro dos Negócios Estrangeiros e Cooperação de Timor-Leste, Dionísio Babo Soares, e o Sr. Embaixador Francisco Seixas da Costa, Presidente do Clube de Lisboa, dando-lhes, desde já, a palavra para a abertura dos trabalhos da conferência.
His Excellency the Eminent Person of G7 Plus, His Excellency the Chair of the G7 Plus, Sr. Paulo Collier, Sr. Presidente do Clube de Lisboa, Dear Ministers from G7 Plus, Srs. Deputados e Deputadas de Timor-Leste e de Portugal, Srs. Embaixadores e Chefes de Missões Estrangeiras, Honorable Speakers, Sr. Luís de Amado, Ladies and Gentlemen. First of all, allow me to express my sincere gratitude for being here in this and the great honor to welcome distinguished dignitaries, honorable ministers, head of delegations, and members of delegations at the Natural Resource for Resilience and Development Conference. I would also like to express my deep appreciation to the G7 Plus and Clube de Lisboa for organizing such an important dialogue and giving the opportunity to all of us to make our contribution on how to effectively manage natural resources and how to face the challenges in conflict-affected countries based on the fundamental premise of self-reliance through its own resources. Ladies and gentlemen, conflict-affected countries that are also called fragile countries are home to 1.5 billion people. Having been living in with legacies of decades of conflict, these countries are lagging behind on social and development benchmarks. More than 80% of the poorest are estimated to be living in countries in fragile situation. On the other hand, most of these countries are rich in valuable natural resources, which, if well managed, can drive economic growth and prosperity. After achieving peace, these countries need a sustainable flow of income in order to sustain peace, reinforce state building, increase resilience, and provide for basic services to the people. The G7 plus countries have so much natural wealth that has the potential to achieve self-reliance. The United Nations Environment Program estimated at least 80% of the fragile states listed by the OECD contain high-value natural resources of strategic relevance to global economy. The most pressing question that faces us today are, why are most of these countries the poorest? Why are these countries heavily dependent on aid? One of these examples is the Democratic Republic of Congo, with natural wealth worth more than $26 trillion. And in nowadays, it is not one of the richest in the region. Instead, it continues to strive and find ways to how to maximize their resources for development. Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, focusing in the serious matter under debate in this conference, it would be appropriate to talk about Timor-Leste. Timor-Leste has made great strides towards securing lasting peace and stability since the independence, and over the past decade has created the conditions for successful development. The statistical database from several national and international organizations show that economic growth in Timor-Leste is expected to accelerate more than 3% in 2019 and almost 5% in 2020. Underscore that this rebound will be supported by stronger public spending, as well as renewed consumer and business confidence. Given the immense power of the visions mobilized, allow me to share with you the projecting visions of a future where the national leaders and the government-led development intend to bring prosperity to every Timorese citizens, and above all, in a well-succeeded image of the sovereignty of Timor-Leste before the world. Sharing these visions, all Timorese citizens assume the national commitment and recognize the legitimacy of the state and thus the political authority to administer the nation's wealth. The Tasimani project, led by the government of Timor-Leste, will spread over a span of 160 kilometers along the north coast of Timor-Leste, include Suai, Betano, and Beasu. It defines the building of a supply base, a port, and an industrial state in Suai, a qualified natural gas plant in Beasu, where the pipeline from Timor Sea is expected to reach shore, an international airport, a refinery and petrochemical plant, as well as a petroleum industry administration city in Betano. By directing oil and gas resources from the Timor Sea and elsewhere onshore to the Timorese south coast for processing the Tasimani project, it is expected that it will create local employment opportunities, boost the national economy, attract foreign investments, and improve the well-being of the population and the next generations as a grant for the sustainability of our whole country. Ladies and gentlemen, it must be, however, understood in the context of the country's contemporary political landscape. A specific historical experience and the paradox of dependency on recognition by a foreign gaze that both authorizes and potentially threatens state's sovereignty. On this latter issue, let me share with you, Excellencies, Timor-Leste's recent experience. It is a country where political stability means economic development in all that matters. After achieving robust economic growth from 2011 onwards, the country began witnessing some economic downturn in 2016. In the last 2 years, Timor-Leste experienced two successive parliamentary elections and changes of government, unprecedented in our democratic history. A minority government was imposed in office, but short-lived and remained operative under a duodecimal budget system with little public investment in the social structure, infrastructure and development. The second fresh election was conducted, but failed short to create a complete and newly installed government because of the refusal still of the president to sworn in half of the members of our government. So although Timor-Leste is on the right track, as I pictured above, and there is a government in place and functions normally, this experience illustrates how political stability and development are intertwined and how one can affect each other equally in a country like ours. Ladies and gentlemen, the common challenge that face the G7 plus countries include lack of peace that further weakens the institutional capacity. Decades of conflict and crisis leave our institutions fragile. Therefore, even after achieving peace, we are unable to manage our resources effectively. The need to survive the hard gained in peace often rush us to explore our resources in less efficient and effective way. In addition, we are overwhelmed by imposed solutions of our well-intentioned development partners, but rarely fit our context. Building institutions and restoring their capacities require resources and time, probably decades. Hence, we need support from our development partners to help us to improve our capacity and strengthen institutions so that we are able to manage natural resources effectively and gain self-reliance. For that reason, G7 Plus agreed on a new deal for engagement in fragile states that guides effective engagement in conflict-affected countries, calling for a collective effort to do things differently, with the recipient countries exercising its leadership. And since the inception, the G7 Plus has promoted peer learning. We call fragile to fragile cooperation. We are benefited from one each other's experience in managing our transition to peace and stability. And such exchange is founded on the spirit of solidarity. Therefore, I have the strong hope that this conference serves as a platform to share experience and build network for our collaboration among the G7 Plus members in the area of natural resources management. I thank you, the G7 Plus organizers, and also Clube de Lisboa for this wonderful conference. I wish you all enjoy the conversation and will benefit from each other's experience. Thank you very much and God bless you.
Senhor Ministro dos Negócios Estrangeiros de Timor-Leste, Sr. Dr. Dionísio Soares, Sr. Presidente do Conselho-Geral da EDP, Presidente Xandana Guzmão, Srs. Ministros, Srs. Embaixadores, Minhas Senhoras e Meus Senhores, eu quero começar por agradecer, em nome do Clube de Lisboa, o excelente acolhimento que nos é dado pela EDP para a organização desta conferência que fazemos em articulação entre o Clube de Lisboa e o G7+. Para aqueles que conhecem menos bem o Clube de Lisboa, eu gostava de lhes dizer que esta é uma organização que existe desde há escassos anos e que tem por objetivo situar a capital portuguesa no centro dos grandes debates internacionais e, em particular, nas questões que se prendem com a globalização e com todos os impactos que isso pode ter sobre a estabilidade. E por isso mesmo, esta articulação entre o Clube de Lisboa e o G7+, é uma das vertentes que nós procuramos trabalhar e colaborar, porque nos parece absolutamente importante, precisamente para aquilo que é a gênese do próprio Clube. A oportunidade desta conferência que nos foi proposta pelo G7+, é mais do que evidente. Estamos hoje num mundo, como aliás o Sr. Ministro teve oportunidade de sublinhar, em que a questão dos recursos naturais e a importância disso para a paz, para a estabilidade e para o próprio florescimento dos sistemas democráticos e para a sustentabilidade desses mesmos sistemas democráticos é fundamental, e por isso mesmo pensámos que era útil fazê-lo aqui em Lisboa, ganhando, digamos, também para a cidade de Lisboa uma certa centralidade, pela capacidade de diálogo e pela capacidade que Portugal sempre demonstrou para colocar as grandes questões do desenvolvimento no centro do debate em Lisboa. Quando falamos em Lisboa, o Clube de Lisboa não é só Lisboa, é também Lisboa, é o Porto. Às vezes algumas pessoas do Porto dizem: porque é que nós não exportamos o Clube de Lisboa um pouco para fora daqui? Vamos fazê-lo com o tempo. Esta é uma organização leve, é uma estrutura muito leve e é uma estrutura de boas vontades, é uma espécie de sopa da pedra que nós procuramos aculturar. E por isso mesmo é nessas boas vontades, e fico muito contente de ver esta sala bem cheia com pessoas interessadas neste debate, que nós vamos levar a cabo esta primeira, que esperamos que seja uma sucessão de conferências bianuais, como o Sr. Ministro referiu, entre o G7+, com o apoio do Clube de Lisboa. E portanto eu desejo, e vou ser muito breve, que a minha intervenção é apenas quase formal, desejo um excelente trabalho, desejo que o debate possa ser útil e desejo que possam regressar a Portugal sistematicamente para podermos utilizar Lisboa, como disse, como um elemento, digamos, uma plataforma para o vosso diálogo. Muito obrigado a todos, muito obrigado e bom trabalho.